I am delighted to be here with you all today. It is nice to see you all once again. Today is a glorious day because we are all gathered here at Zion Lutheran Church in Wilshire, Ohio, to receive the gifts of God and to meditate on His Word. Our text will be our gospel lesson, and we'll be paying particular attention to the beginning where Jesus was teaching us about the work of the Holy Spirit. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified. Amen. Now, I am sure that many of you have heard the accusation that the Lutheran Church is a spiritless church, or at least that we are weak on the Holy Spirit. You may have heard something to this effect: you Lutherans follow dead ritual. You quench the Spirit, there is no place for Him to move in your liturgy. Or perhaps you have heard, you Lutherans are so emotionless. But in our church, you can feel the presence of the Holy Spirit. Or you Lutherans are not open to a word from the Spirit. Now, it is true we do not talk about the Holy Spirit as often as we talk about Jesus. But that's not because the Holy Spirit is not present. No, indeed, the Lutheran Church is the most Spirit-filled church in the world. There is no church body with more truly spiritual worship, no church body in which the Holy Spirit is more clearly present, no church body in which the Word of the Spirit is more clearly proclaimed, and no church body in which the Holy Spirit more generously lavishes His gifts upon God's people. On the night when He was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ continued to teach His disciples what He must do, what He must do for the salvation of the world. He says, "A little while, and you will see me no longer. And again, in a little while, and you will see me." Jesus has already explicitly predicted His death three times to the disciples, saying, "The Son of Man is going to be betrayed into the hands of men. They will kill Him, and after 3 days He will rise." Jesus has taught them that He must be betrayed into the hands of His enemies, that He must be mocked, He must be scourged, that He must be crucified and buried, and that He must rise again. All of this to pay for the consequences of our sins. And yet, the disciples, as usual, don't understand what Jesus is talking about. Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." But His disciples said to one another, "What is this that He says to us?" After being with Jesus and hearing His teaching for 3 years, they still do not understand the center of the gospel promise. They do not understand what Jesus has come to do. But Jesus gives them another promise. "The Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, He will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all that I have said." The Holy Spirit will lead the apostles into understanding and will bring to their minds all of Jesus' work and all that Jesus has taught, all of this so that they may be His witnesses to the world. This is the job of the Holy Spirit, to empower the apostles to proclaim what Christ has done. Although this promise was given specifically to the apostles, the gift of the Holy Spirit to the apostles is a gift for the entire church. For the testimony and witness of the apostles is written in the Holy Scriptures. On account of Christ's word and promise given to the apostles, we know that the Scriptures are not just written by men, but are inspired by the Holy Spirit. The Scriptures are the living word of the Holy Spirit given to us today to testify about Jesus and to empower us to be His witnesses to the world. Through this knowledge and faith worked in the apostles, hearts by the Holy Spirit, Jesus gives them joy. He says, "So also you have sorrow now, but I will see you again, and your hearts will rejoice, and no one will take your joy from you." This is not the joy that the world gives, like the pleasant sensation you get from eating a piece of chocolate cake. A fleeting moment of joy. It is the joy won by Christ for you on the cross. It is the promise that God has forgiven all of your sins, and that no matter what suffering you endure, you are in His hands. And that death is not the end of the story. We see this work of the Holy Spirit in the apostles in Acts. These men, who after the crucifixion hid behind closed doors, now in the Holy Spirit go into the streets to proclaim what Christ has done and the mighty works of God. According to Christ Himself, this is the job of the Holy Spirit. Christ says, "When the Spirit of truth comes, He will guide you into all truth. For He will not speak on His own authority, but whatever He hears from Me, He will speak." Again, Jesus says, "He will glorify Me, for He will take what is Mine and declare it to you." The Holy Spirit does not speak His own words, but He speaks Christ's words. The Spirit does not glorify Himself, but He glorifies Jesus. The Spirit does not testify to Himself, but He testifies to Christ. If we want to be a little tongue-in-cheek, we can say that the Holy Spirit is the shy guy of the Holy Trinity, because He does not point to Himself, but He points always to Jesus. If you are in a church that is always proclaiming the Spirit this, the Spirit that, the Spirit, you are in a church that is quenching the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit's work is to proclaim Christ. You see, Jesus even gives His apostles the specific content of the message that they are to preach. He says, "When the Holy Spirit comes, He will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment." The Holy Spirit will convict the world concerning sin because He will preach the law to them, saying, "All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. All are by nature children of wrath. None is righteous, no, not one. No one understands, no one seeks for God. All have turned aside together, they have become worthless. No one does good, not even one." The Spirit will convict the world concerning righteousness because the Holy Spirit will preach the gospel. That is, there is no condemnation in Christ Jesus. The Lord Jesus died for your forgiveness. He is risen for your justification, and He has ascended to the right hand of the Father. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by His grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, the Apostle Paul says. And the Spirit will convict the world concerning judgment because law and gospel are not just some psychological game that we play on Sunday mornings, where we preach the law for half the sermon so that you feel bad about yourselves, and then preach the gospel for the second half so that you feel good about Jesus. The world is indeed under the judgment of God, and salvation is only won through Jesus Christ. It is a real and eternal salvation that is a real answer to a real judgment. Jesus descended from heaven to snatch you from the jaws of hell and to bring you to everlasting life. And this is why I say that the Lutheran Church is the most Spirit-filled church on earth, because here Christ is proclaimed. Our liturgy has not just been conjured up by the imagination of men, but from start to finish, it quotes from the Scriptures, the very word of the Holy Spirit. It does not quench the Spirit, but it immerses you in His living word and declares to you from start to finish the redemption won for you through Jesus Christ. From the pulpit, at least I hope so, you hear the Spirit preach to you that you are a sinner and Jesus is the Savior of sinners. The Spirit gives you eyes to see not just bread and wine on the table, but the body and blood of Christ descended from heaven, given to you for the forgiveness of sins. And in baptismal water, the Spirit is poured out upon you, and he glorifies Jesus by declaring that you belong to Christ, that you have died with him in baptism, and that you will rise with him again in a life like his. Jesus' life is your life. Jesus' righteousness is your righteousness. Jesus' sonship is your sonship, so that you all are children of the Father. This is the work of the Holy Spirit, to declare what Christ has done for you and give it to you. In all these things, the Spirit creates faith and sustains it in you. Blessed be God the Father. Blessed be God the Son, who is one with the Father. Blessed be God the Holy Spirit, who is glorified and glorifies and testifies to the Son. Amen.